What was it like growing up? It was fun and fantastic. My sister is a little, you know, not is, she used to be a little more of a tomboy than I was. So she used to play with the boys and all of that, I remember. I grew up very, very quickly. And so suddenly I wasn't playing with the boys as much. That was a bummer. But otherwise, childhood consisted of climbing trees, jumping off rooftops, you know, playing in the open air, playing with a ball, climbing roofs in dresses even, you know, that flew up like this and stuff. It wasn't so bad. No, I don't think I particularly felt bad that, you know, oh my God, she's growing up as a girl. So we were always empowered. There was me, my mom and my sister. So I come from a family of empowered women who have gone through their struggles, yeah. But it was never... In fact, my mother, I remember, used to say, because she has seen so many, you know, she's been through that space where the boy child was given a little more bhav, as we call it. So she used to tell me if, you know, that she had decided that if she had had sons, then they would have had to do all the housework. So she actually pampered us quite a bit because we were daughters. She thought we were special. It's good. I'm just worried that if I was a boy, my mother would have really... Because she was of the belief, I think, because of the stuff she saw in and around, that men and women should be treated equal. And, you know, which is still the struggle. Somehow it's so crazy. And she believed that if there was a boy in the house, that he would learn to do everything that a girl was supposed to do. Which I thought was very sweet of my mother, very awesome of my mother. But then she, you know, she kind of relaxed because we were girls. And she said, hey, they don't have to work as much. So that was the extent of it. But otherwise, I think we were women with our head on our shoulders. Did I think there was anything I couldn't do? It's too far back to remember, but I remember for the longest, only playing with the boys after a certain age. I was like, dang, my sister gets to play with the boys. She had a very athletic build. I wasn't. I was like a super curvy girl. Was lagu nahi hota abhi, is. So that was the only part I really missed. Playing with the boys after a certain point, because then, you know, they looked at you a certain way and you felt a certain way, or, you know, that kind of stuff. But I remember the first thing I wanted to be was an astronaut, and then I wanted to be a police officer. These were my two, like, you know, sane goals, because then after that they were all entertainment oriented. So I think, no, there was no boy-girl distinction in our heads. In fact, we've gone through spaces and times where I think most men would have crumpled. It's not as... I really think you make your own destiny, frankly, but I think that there are circumstances that bring you to a place that you would be best suited to. So I think I had lots of these things in my head. I wanted to be an actor. I am. I wanted to be, you know, so many things, so many different things. But I think the way the universe played it was that FM radio in the country mushroomed at a time that I was just out of college, and, you know, I had all these options, and I was like, what can I do? Hey, I can talk. So literally it was one of those things. I went for an audition. They kind of fell in love with me. I didn't even know I was that good, frankly. I still don't know. I mean, you know, different people could have different opinions, but I've been told that I'm damn good and all that. I've been told that I energize people, which is good. It's a good thing to have. I don't think it's just what you say. It's how you say it. It's the energies. So, it so happened that I was, you know, the right person at the right place at the right time. And yes, radio happened, and it's happening for a really long time now. In fact, I think I'm the longest running morning DJ in our country on radio, yeah. I majored in political science, actually, and then I got into the media. I did my course called Social Communication Media at a university here at, you know, Sapphires in Mumbai. I'm saying here. So I finished my social communications media at a college in Mumbai, which stressed on media with, you know, it wasn't just go-getter media. It was media keeping society in mind. And at that point, I didn't think that it really impacted me, but I think probably it did, because, you know, the way I work on radio, it's a lot of entertainment. But it also comes from a social point of view, you know, what can we do better our lot, to make it better for people, to make it better for ourselves, kind of thing. I was talking about how radio can be a medium for so much more. I think it's also like, you know, old wine, it matures and it's better. So it's not like you should start and stop. It's as you grow with the brand, you grow with your thoughts. It's a great space to be. So like in the beginning, you know, you change in any job, it was different. I started out, they used to call me bubbly. I hated the word bubbly, but I think they just meant my energy. Because bubbly also sounds a little vacuous, like you don't have a brain. And that's really not true of me. It's just because somebody has energy doesn't mean they're vacuous. So with time, I realized it was also very, the kind of approach we had at the radio station or who I was very hard hitting. It was very like, this is this and this is this and so this is this. And it was fun and it was smart and all of that. But at some point, we were of the view that we need to have a heart so that people don't just see us as this. You need to be like a whole person. So that approach was taken for my show and for the radio station. And we started this thing called Bajao for a Cause, where every year we got the whole city to collaborate. And we picked up, or rather I picked up a cause that was close to my heart that I believed in so that I could talk about it. You really need to believe in what you're talking about, otherwise you can't do it. So there were very many things that came up. So over the years, there were kids with AIDS, affected, infected. There were kids who, you know, terminally ill kids who wanted their last wishes to come true. There were kids the BMC school kids who would go to... who would go to school, their parents would send them to school only because they got lunch there. If they didn't go to school, they would probably be out on the roads begging or stealing. And they only went to school because they didn't have to feed them. And so that sustenance was important. What the show basically did, or what I basically did, was got the city to come together to think outside of what they just generally think about, which is their life, their wife, their money, their kids, and think beyond themselves, which was supremely satisfying for everyone concerned. For the people, because they got to come through a medium that they trusted. They believed in my credibility that if, you know, Malishka is saying this, she has researched it, she must be right, which is true, we research it a lot. Then of course it's help for the people involved. And for me, it's supremely satisfying to see a city of 20 million strong, and most of them at some point or the other who have associated themselves with a cause and, you know, felt good, done good, and thought about something other than themselves. This time we took up the cause of commercial sex workers and their kids, because the thought that when we spoke to them, when I, you know, I first go and meet whoever it is I'm going to do the cause with. So when we met them, we realized that they're there because of circumstances. Nobody is really there because they like it. Okay, so there were people who actually asked me this, which was also welcome. Like, yeah, some of them are there because they want to do it. I was like, nobody. I promise you, they got there because somebody cheated them, somebody threw them out, somebody hurt them. Some story like that, but they want a better future for their kids. At least most of them want a better future for their kids. And so let's do it for them. And the city came together beautifully. We collected over, in 3 weeks, the city pledged, and this is radio, I'm talking about pledging on radio, 30 lakhs plus in 3 weeks, that's big. Overall, we managed to give them 1 crore rupees. In 3 weeks, that is phenomenal. I mean, and that's a whole city coming together. So, and lots of karma points, Mumbai. I remember the second time that I went to the space where the commercial sex workers were. So this is the area called Kamatipura, and you can't really go there. You can't go there by yourself. But because we were doing all of this and we had these people who were so amazing, one of the guys who was born and brought up in Kamatipura and who was earlier somebody who would get women into the trade and is now reformed, took us in there. And when he took us in there, they threw flowers on me. It's a street, right? It's dingy streets, dirty streets, less gutters. But they had women come out and throw shower flowers on us. And I was like, what? You can't really shoot their faces and everything. I did a bit of shooting, but the gratification that you get at that point is amazing. I got into a couple of houses where nobody has been, only because, you know, we went on a trust basis that there won't be a camera in there, that there'll only be voices recorded. And yes, you could see there were madams, there were pimps, there were different levels of people, there were kids, there were so many kids, it scared me so much, because these kids are going to be brought up in that environment, and if we don't help them, then, you know, there's a second generation of, you know, commercial sex workers, either the women or pimps. And they're very warm people, all said and done. They know, I mean, they feel that this is their lot, this is where they belong, this is what's going to happen to them. So they live as a community. They live in harmony and, you know, in peace and all of that. And I think a lot of them are just resigned that this is my life and I've come here from somewhere else. Somebody sold me. This is what I have to do. But yes, they do have madams. And I met one commercial sex worker who was very, very feisty. I asked her so many, you know, questions in depth. I asked her whether she stays protected, whether she's hurt, whether she's fed well, whether she's taken care of, what about her kids. So I loved that in so many ways. She was like, yes, I'm always protected. I take care, you know, that protection is being used. That I think is a big form of empowerment, because very many people don't get that. I mean, lots of people, they have no say in, and most people are in that situation, they have no say in how they are used or how they are abused. You know, they have a customer, and like in so many industries, customer is king. So if, you know, they don't want to use a condom, if they want to, you know, have cigarette butts, you know, lit on their bodies, if they want to beat them, if they want to starve them, whatever it is gets done. For me, I think empowerment for these women would be if, of course, they could get out of it and maybe not do it. But if they're going to stay in that space, then that it happens on their terms, that their health is taken care of, that they get health benefits, that, you know, that they don't get dragged away from their homes, that their kids are taken care of, that their medical is taken care of. This for them, within that space, if they have to live there, for them, that is, they're not exploited, you know. Like I remember she said, this woman was so hungry that this, she went to this guy and she said, I will have sex with you for 5 rupees, because that's how, 5 rupees is nothing. It's silch. I will have sex with you for 5 rupees because I need to eat vada pav. That's it. She just needed to eat some bread. And then she said, this is what. So that level of, you know, is just, and as a result of all of that, the kind of stuff they get forced to do is really sad. So empowerment for them would be exactly this, that all their rights are taken care of and their health is taken care of. You know that the feminine is softer, but not necessarily not powerful or weak. Yeah, and the male again is maybe hard and broad, but doesn't mean he doesn't have a soft side. It's ridiculous, this argument. So yeah, and the ability to make my own choices, to not be forced, you know, down any tunnel. Also at the same time, not be stubborn about if somebody's telling me, like to be able to to be able to hear them out. It's not necessary, I'm empowered, so you can't tell me anything. No, that's not the scene. You can, and to be able to listen to it with an educated, calm, still mind. To be able to make decisions, of course, which I am doing. And yeah, to be able to take care of, this is if women, if you were talking about women, I'll tell you this. I love giving out this stat. When men are about 60% sure about anything that they want to do, they go ahead and they do it. Women wait till they're 100% sure, which is great because we're perfectionists, but it's also silly because as a result, we don't end up doing a lot of things that we want to do. The woman also does not take care of her health as much as, you know, the martyr mother, the weeping wife who will always be like, no, I will wait for my husband to come. But you can't wait for him to come home if he comes home at 12 o'clock. You're supposed to have dinner at 9 o'clock so that you can sleep at 11. You know, I mean, just take care of yourself, yeah. So all these things are really important. Women just need to take care of themselves better and of their dreams better. I mean, and you have to find an empowered partner. Is very important. Please find an empowered partner. Otherwise, you're in trouble. If Sasuma is asking you like, oh, kidhar gayi thi? Why you're in trouble? You should be treated as souls, you know, as two individual souls, not like a gen. Not your, what's between your legs shouldn't define you, that, oh, she can only do this or he can only do this. And Ravan was not all that bad a guy from what I heard. There are different accounts of the same story. That's the good thing about stories, or that's the strange thing about stories. There are always different accounts. There's no such thing as the truth. When you say Shakti, what comes to mind? Somehow I think Kali with her nice long tongue and everything. But that's like one, I think that's what comes to everyone's mind. But Shakti is power in the most basic sense of the word. Dignity, I think, is also Shakti. To be able to speak your mind is Shakti to me. And yeah, to be able to own who you are. I mean, with your green dress and your great mind and your you know, cheerful attitude and all of it, just to be able to embrace yourself and, you know, live your life fruitfully. What's in the future for me? You know, like a lot of your paths get paved as you really, you know, you cannot plan so much for the future. You should have like a fluid plan and all of that. But that's about it. I hope I will be doing a lot of good work. But I hope I can be an entertainer. I hope I can do films. You know, this is not, I must tell you, it's not just all ke main bitch jana chahti hu. I'm not Mother Teresa. I'm not a politician. I'm a regular girl with regular ambitions, but who is able to, in the space that she's provided to her, thankfully in this life, been able to extend and reach beyond. I want to maybe, you know, another girl with a similar mind in my place might have been able to do the same thing. But that's all you need to have. You need to have an intent and some kind of innocence, which I really believe I do. You're smart and yet you're innocent at some level, you know. You don't let corruption hit you in ways that will affect you. So, yeah, so I'm hoping that there'll be lots of movies and I'm hoping there will be adventures, there'll be lots of travel and diving and yeah, that's about it. I hope it'll be brilliant, yeah. It'll be good. Whatever it is will be good.